So I was just beginning to say that social policy is very important. It guides social development and aims at creating a better life for all, and mainly addresses the development deficits and social insecurities that we experience. Also very importantly, social policy creates conditions for economic development. In fact, there's a symbiotic relationship between social and economic policy that is not often recognized. Although these days lip service is paid to this relationship, we do not recognize it, but it creates the conditions that make ensure that social policies succeed. And thirdly, it provides the glue that holds society together in promoting social cohesion. For those reasons, social policy is quite key when we think about structural transformation. And the way I understand structural transformation is that it speaks to four processes which are economic and demographic. One, the declining share of agriculture in GDP and employment. Two, rapid urbanization, which results from rural-urban migration. Three, the expansion of industrial and service sectors. And last but not least, a demographic transition from high to low rates of births and deaths. And this is not my definition. It's a common definition of structural transformation. But if we accept this definition, what it implies is that we are talking about an economy and society in which agriculture is no longer quite different from other sectors in terms of productivity and the location of poverty, and that we have an economy which enjoys sustained growth and development, mainly because it's diversified and also has high levels of value addition and productivity of all its economic activities. Now, and whilst this definition is generic, it's important to underline that different countries have different experiences of structural transformation, and that it does not always lead to social development or the reduction of inequalities. And this is where social policy comes in. At the same time, we also know that we have to deal sustainably with the issues of employment and economic development, the kinds of issues that have animated us in this discussion so far. If we look at the state of African economies and societies at this time, and I missed yesterday's presentations, and I imagine they talked a lot about this. One is that the majority of African countries have not experienced structural transformation, at least not of the kind that we mean by those four definitions. What we find in most African countries is a failure of agrarian transitions and structural transformation. And we can see it in the four decades of jobless growth, the growing informalization of work and insecurity of work. We can also see it in the widening inequalities and the weaknesses in social cohesion and so on. And the speakers before me talked a bit about this. And we can also see it in the increasingly weakening bargaining position of organized labor, the acute social insecurities that people face, particularly with the global financial, food and energy crisis and so on. And I think the lesson here is that social development is not an inevitable outcome of economic policy, and that one needs deliberation to bring this about. Clearly, we need more deliberation to ensure that economic growth leads to social development. Again, in the current context, it's important to point out that there are some new opportunities for beginning to rethink social policy. One is in the Pan-African agenda of structural transformation. This is a big opportunity. Secondly, the AU has a social policy framework for Africa, which they passed in 2008, which I'd like to refer us to. And then also, social policy is back on the global national agendas once more, particularly in the discussions of the post-MDGs and the social, the global sustainable development goals and so on and so forth. So these are good opportunities to begin to think about social policy. In my presentation which follows, I want us to think about four questions. One of them is that what role should social policy play in employment creation, in structural transformation and equitable development? Secondly, what kind of social policy do we need? And thirdly, under what conditions will it be effective? And last but not least, what's the role for state and civil society? I wanted to offer this definition of social policy, which resonates very deeply with me because I think it basically covers what we mean when we talk about transformative social policy. It says that social policy involves collective interventions which directly affect social welfare, social institutions, and social relations. So it's not just social welfare it affects. It affects social relations and also social relations. It's concerned with the redistributive effects of economic policy, the protection of people from the vagaries of the market and the changing circumstances of age, the enhancement of the productive production of members of potential of members of society, and the reconciliation of the burden of reproduction with that to other social tasks. Successful societies have given social policies all these tasks, although the weighting of tasks has been varied among countries and within each country from period to period. In offering a discussion of social policy, the OECD, for example, has shown that it has three main components. One aspect has to do with quality of life. The second has to do with material conditions, and the third with sustainability over time. I won't go into these details because we don't have time, but you find that many of the things that concern social policy are in here. Now, social policy has been with us for a very long time, since the colonial period. And in the colonial period, it was mainly paternalistic welfare, part of the civilizing mission. But there were distinctions between what was being done in rural areas and urban areas. But largely, it was in two broad areas, education and health. And in terms of education, it was mostly primary basic education and vocational training and that kind of thing. And for health, there was a lot of concern about disease. So immunization was big, public health issues, tropical diseases, hygiene, sexually transmitted diseases. Those were the kinds of preoccupations of social policy. In that period, social policy resided with social welfare departments. There were also some broad concerns with the reproduction of rural producers. So for example, in the colonial period in Ghana, the colonial state was very interested in peasant indebtedness, providing extension services to farmers and so on. And I believe this was not just in Ghana. In the structural adjustment period, we realized that there was a huge sea change in social policies, but one of the big things that happened was the separation between social and economic policy. So for example, economic policies no longer had employment as a goal, and governments even stopped collecting data on employment and other social indicators. They left that to the World Bank and the UN to do. When social policies were introduced, there was a privileging of market-based social policy instruments. And here again, you could see a huge influence of global and regional institutions and a less proactive role for national states. The very early social development policies were actually about social safety nets, really to deal with the fallouts of structural adjustment, the whole adjustment to the human face and a set of safety net policies. Eventually, we moved into a situation where there was interest in what we call social protection measures. But these were a narrower set of measures, which I will talk about in a minute. And what was significant in this period was that the elite also opted out of out of social policy measures. They tended to deal with their own issues privately, take their children out of their countries for education, or seek health solutions elsewhere. So just a few words about the current features of social policy, particularly the social protection agendas that Jomo was talking about earlier. Now, one of their key features is that they are centered on poverty rather than a focus on equality and social solidarity. So basically, they target the deserving poor, and they do not think of social policy in universal terms. An important feature they have because of this focus on the poor has been this separation between social protection and employment. They basically are not focused on entitlements that come from the work that people have done. Instead, they try and help the deserving poor to deal with some of the fallouts of economic policies. They tend to deal with single issue matters. So if there's poverty, then there are cash transfers. If children are not going to school, then there's a school feeding program, and so on and so forth. But every issue is seen as a single issue to be settled by a particular policy. And mostly all these things are being done within the neoliberal economic framework. And although family and state are recognized as important domains of risk management, much weight has been placed on market instruments for risk management. So I already mentioned some of the popular instruments, the cash transfers, health insurance, microfinance, school feeding and capping of school fees, and so on and so forth. The critique of these measures is not because there's a problem with being concerned about social protection per se. After all, social policy has to include protection. It is that this is a very narrow vision of social policy, which is supposed to have a broader vision for it to really make a difference to society. And secondly, there's the concern that in accepting social protection, we keep the disconnection between economic and social policy. And then this sole focus on poverty and vulnerability and the preference for means testing and targeting is also quite problematic because there are people who earn more than $1 to $5 a day who are suffering, but they are not seen as poor people, and therefore they have nothing to cover them. Some people also want these protection measures because they are affordable, and yet the benefits have been quite meager when measured against the scale of the problems faced by poor people. And last but not the least, there's concern that the whole focus on social protection has led to solutions and instruments brought to us from outside the African continent. Other people have tried cash transfers in Latin America, and they are doing well, so Africa must try them. Credit is good in Asia, so Africa has to try microcredit and so on and so forth. And this has basically removed the autonomy of policymaking and so on from Africa. Also, these goals are very, very minimal. Even the MDGs and primary education and so on are quite minimal. Last but not the least, we also do not have evidence that the poverty-centric policies actually reduce poverty. There's no evidence that this is what has happened. And then all the non-universal social provisioning produces resentment amongst the middle classes and the people who do not have money but are not poor. At the same time, they stigmatize the poor, and there's not much concern that the poor can actually do things for themselves if given the right conditions. If you look at the AU social policy framework for Africa, interestingly, it's a complicated document in the sense that it's firmly within the neoliberal agenda, but at the same time tries to move away from it. And I'll share a few segments of it with you for you to see the ways in which it conforms to the neoliberal agenda and also the ways in which it tries to depart from it. The document says of itself that it was developed to complement and supplement ongoing... Is that it? Okay. It was developed to complement and supplement ongoing national and regional program and policy initiatives such as the PRSPs and NEPAD, and to close the gap where it was deemed that these did not adequately address social justice issues. So basically, it's not challenging these neoliberal agendas that we have going on in Africa. It basically wants to address their fallouts. The framework treats social development as subordinate to economic growth, but justifies social development as a goal in its own right. It acknowledges that while economic growth is a necessary condition of social development, it is not exclusively or sufficiently able to address the challenges posed by the multifaceted socioeconomic and political forces that generate the continent's social development challenges. So this is how the document describes itself, as basically how to correct the problems of economic development. But when it defines social policy, suddenly it adopts the definitions of social policy that are adopted by the critics of the neoliberal agenda. So I find that interesting, and I don't know how it happened. So if you look at its definitions in its own words, it says that it underlines the centrality of the state and society to the development agenda. Social policy involves state interventions and collaborative working relations with society. Social development is not left to the invisible hand of the market. It emphasizes the instrumental value of social policy to secure and improve the living conditions of people, and talks about human security as an important development goal in its own right. It also says that social policy should not be limited to social welfare, and it should not be micronized or sectorialized. These are its own words. And rather, it should be viewed as a web of policies that act in a complementary, multidimensional, multisectoral, and multidisciplinary matter. And it quotes Tandika Nkandawire, who is more or less the father of transformational social policy during his time at UNRISD and so on. So it's that kind of document, contradictory in the ways in which many of these documents are. It has guiding principles that, I mean, one can only agree with. For example, it says that it must be intimately linked to economic and political policies aimed at advancing society's well-being. And policy for social development as a broader goal should be coordinated with, but not subordinate to, economic growth and political development, etc., etc. It should be long-term in perspective. It should include bottom-up approaches and so on. Different stakeholders should work together in coordinated partnerships. Again, nothing to disagree with here. The recommendations it makes about employment are also in that same vein. Again, they are very broad-ranging. They hark back to other agreements that the AU has penned. It focuses on things like youth unemployment. It places employment at the center of economic policies, including employment targeting and conducive working conditions. This is a very Keynesian approach to economic policy, which is not what we are about at the moment in Africa and so on. And so forth. He talks about the informal economy. In fact, it has a very good discussion about problems of informal work and the informal economy, and talks about removing the challenges of the informal economy and so on and so forth. So many very useful recommendations that we can think about as trade unionists and as researchers interested in the role of employment in social policy. In terms of the idea of transformational social policy, I just want to share with you just a few points about its conception and issues. One of the key things is the complementarity between economic and social policy, and the fact that they need to have synergies. And I think this is a very important point, which has implications for those of us thinking about social policy, that we cannot remain in the realm of social policy. We have to worry about economic policies and their contradictions with social policies, and ensure that economic policies complement social policies. So, for example, economic policies that are creating jobless growth clearly have to go, because they are not compatible with social, transformational social policy we want. It's also important to therefore see that there will be macroeconomic policies, there will be also sectoral policies, and that they have to shift to ensure that social policy is effective. The second main point is that we have to agree that social policy has multiple functions. And here I want to stress this issue. And because social policy which focuses on only one of these is not going to be transformational. Social policy has to support production and has to improve productive capacities and ensure that workers are in a position to produce and therefore to gain from production. It has to support reproduction, which is what mostly is relegated to women and is unpaid. It has to support protection, which is what a lot of social protection measures seek to do now. It has to support redistribution. It has to be focused on addressing the big inequalities that we see in our society these days. It has to be concerned with social cohesion and nation building as well. Jimmy Adesina has a very good paper talking about this issue of transformational social policy, and I recommend it to you. Thirdly, we have to return to this idea of a universalist social policy. I think we have very good examples from around the world which help us to see that this is not utopia and that this is something which has been done and has been shown to deal better with many of the developmental problems we have. Another point about this is that there's an important role for the state here. It has to do a lot more than it's willing to do under the market-led social policies that are being used at the moment. It has to set parameters, and it also has to worry about financing and so on. And that while the private sector continues to have a role, it must not replace the state in social policy. If we think about transformational social policy, there are some parameters that we have to consider, particularly for African societies. One of them is demography, that we have to take into account the demographic characteristics of our society, the fertility, mortality, population growth rates, the age structure, the whole thing about the youth bulge, the impacts of certain diseases. It used to be HIV, AIDS, we now have Ebola to worry about and so on. We really have to be concerned about those things. Another huge issue has to do with education and skills. Hitherto, we've tended to see these things as soft issues and things that we pay attention to because of social welfare. But they're actually very key to the structural transformation of the economy, a healthy, well-skilled population. And then there's the issue of health and malnutrition. Jomo talked about the problem of malnutrition. The thing is that the most worrisome thing about malnutrition is that it carries workers throughout their lives. If a child is malnutrition, they become a worker that can never produce to their full capacity. And therefore, clearly, all the quality of life and material conditions of the population need to be taken into account in thinking about social policy. The other aspect of it has to do with the structure of the economy, and Sam's presentation and Jomo's presentation talk about this issue of the agrarian economy. When we think of social policy, we have to remember that most incomes are subject to the variations of agricultural activity, that the majority of people in our countries are not employees, they are self-employed and they are smallholders. So what kind of social policies will support smallholders? We also know that another huge chunk of our population are mostly in informal work, indecent, precarious, again, a lot of self-employment. Again, it raises questions about the kinds of social policies that we need to support this kind of population. The third has to do with our own existing cultures of social solidarity. We have numerous traditional mechanisms that deal with economic uncertainty. Rural-urban migration has new mechanisms. Basically, for social policy to be effective, it has to take into account these informal mechanisms and their implications, because sometimes these informal mechanisms are not perfect, and they also raise problems of their own about hierarchies in our society and so on, which social policy has to pay attention to. Last but not the least, we have to pay attention to how we finance social policy. There are all sorts of ideas about social policy as a luxury. We can only afford it if we grow, or if we have a certain level of per capita income and so on. If we think transformationally, clearly, it's a chicken and egg thing. We need good social policies to grow and also to have a certain per capita income, and that there are these mutually reinforcing relationships that we have to pay attention to. Taxation remains the most important instrument for financing social policy. And there are issues to pay attention to in relation to personal income, but also corporate income. And many of these require political will, rationalization of expenditures, the reallocation of domestic resources, and so on. And basically, allowing states to have the fiscal space, which allows them to earn enough from their taxes to allow them to finance social policy. So just to wind down, I think trade unions have a pivotal role to play as part of the social movement in helping to structure social policy. One of the reasons for this is that trade unions actually have a lot of experience with social policy, which they can share with the rest of society. And this should happen both at the national and Pan-African levels. At the same time, the trade unions have their own learning curve, which they have to deal with in order to be up to this leadership task. One, they have to understand and address the situation of labor in the agrarian and urban informal economy better than they've been doing so far. It was interesting when Professor Mio said that there are not many research centers focusing on agrarian issues. And somebody also said that there were very few agriculture-based trade unions. These are the things that have to shift so that trade unions can be up to their leadership. So in conclusion, I've been saying that transformative social policy is fundamental to promote employment, also structural transformation, and also equitable development. And that its role is to complement economic policy, but it's important in its own right and should not be subsumed to economic policy. It implies state engagement and a proactive and preventive approach to social policy, because many things are easier to prevent than to cure. And many times we are running one step behind the disasters of poor social policy. We also have to take our current conditions into account to design the kind of social policies that are best for us: population, economic structure, sociocultural factors, and the question of financing social policy. Affordability of social policy has to be matched against its effectiveness. Thank you.